Over these past 4 weeks, we have been traveling together looking for the light of the world. We were invited by the season of Advent and the writings of Dr. Amy Jill Levine. As we've traveled, we have been aware that the days were growing shorter and the nights longer. Last night was the longest night of our year, a time known to our ancestors as the winter solstice, and it is a time that is a turning point. While we have been living in the midst of this astronomical darkness, many of us have been aware that we are also living in a physical or emotional darkness. At certain points in our lives, all of us have felt, or perhaps we are feeling now, as if the lights have gone out in our life. The things happening in our personal lives are compounded these days by the overwhelming issues in our country. Each and every day we are inundated with the sad story that is being written about religion, about faith, about morality and character and goodness. This is a story that is harming all of us. It's eroding our faith in each other, it's eroding our faith in our government and our leaders, and it's eroding our faith in God. Yet I believe with all my heart that the key to changing our world is changing the story. Unfortunately, we have been given few tools to help us understand how we can find our way in the dark. Barbara Brown Taylor, the great preacher and writer, wrote that learning to walk in the dark requires that we let go of things we have been taught about the dark, including the idea that darkness is always bad and light is always good. Especially this time of the year when we are surrounded by the brilliance of Christmas lights, we forget that for much of our lives, we live in the dark. Perhaps we forgot because we have been told over and over that being afraid of the dark is the true path. I was terrified of the dark as a child, and maybe you were too. This terrain then is most familiar to us because we were so afraid of the dark. Some suggest it is because of these childhood fears that we continue to feel the untruth that darkness is synonymous with evil, and that all that is light and bright and brilliant is good. This falsehood became very real to me during the time I was at a church in Dallas. Our music director, who was Black and one of our greatest supporters, who was from Pakistan, came to me one day and said, "Do you realize that even though we are busting through so many layers of patriarchy by using beautiful, inclusive language for God, we are only perpetuating racism by continuing to reinforce that darkness is bad and light is good in our liturgy and in our worship." In the brilliance of the phenomenal worship that we were creating, it never dawned on me that this language of darkness and light was so harmful. Unbeknownst to many of us, we are hampered by the brilliance and by this embedded belief that at best hinders us from seeing the gifts in darkness, and at its worst, encourages prejudices, however subconscious, against those with dark skin. The irony is that the one whose birth we celebrate at Christmas was a person with dark skin. Could it be that in this season of Advent, in this time of holy waiting, the story for us lies in realizing Christ did not come to dispel the darkness, but to teach us to dwell in the darkness and the light with integrity, compassion, and love in the midst of ambiguity? At the beginning of Advent this year, a minister, a female Baptist minister in Houston, wrote an article titled, What If White Christians Had a More Realistic Image of Jesus, a Dark-Skinned Religious Minority Refugee. At this time of the year in her neighborhood, Reverend Mayo writes, baby Jesus can be found on almost every corner. Living in Texas, I can tell you this is true. Jesus in plastic, Jesus in painted wood, Jesus held by his mother, Jesus laying in the manger. But one thing these neighborhood versions of the Christ child have in common, she writes, is their coloring. Every single Jesus is white. Some have blonde hair and blue eyes. Reverend Mayo, who seems rather mild-mannered, I've heard, which of course some people say about me until they get to know me, calls us to account when she asks, what might our world, our country, be like if modern renditions of Jesus made him look like the Middle Eastern Jew that he was? The earliest depiction of the Madonna and Child is said to be found in the Catacomb of Priscilla in Rome. This wall painting shows a seated Madonna breastfree feeding her child who has turned his head on the audience. The pictorial or sculptural representation of Madonna and Child is one of the most interpreted subjects in Christian art, and yet almost all of these beautiful interpretations remain traditional images of Western culture. In the last several years, I have been drawn to artists who are turning the tide, the artists who are pushing the boundaries of both the visual and narrative meaning of Madonna and Child. One of those artists, Jan Richardson, reminds us that the one who grew in the fertile darkness of Mary's womb knew that darkness is not evil of itself. Rather, it can become the tending place in which our longings for healing, justice, and peace grow and come to birth. The season of Advent, the story of Mary, has invited us to remember that we are people who belong to an astounding story, that in a time when the shadows were deep, a time when it seemed as if the world was ending, God took flesh and came among us as love incarnate. The deep shadows of the world, of course, did not cease to exist with the coming of Jesus. We know that the world is always ending somewhere. Yet the presence of so much pain in the world does not negate or diminish this story. It makes the need more acute, and in fact, it makes it more necessary than ever. To be people of peace, of hope, of joy, to be people with a cause to share in a broken world does not mean living in denial of the brokenness. It means turning toward the brokenness so that we might find the face of love that lives there. It means believing in the promise of potential that we have as a community of faith. Every time we bear witness to this love, in our words, in our music, in acts of justice, large and small, with every resource we have at hand. It means refusing to allow suffering to silence us, and instead to let love find an echo in and through each one of us. The season of Advent asks us to wait, to live in and with the darkness, and seek the Christ who shows up even, and sometimes especially, on the longest night of the year, when we and our world are enveloped in the darkness. At the same time, we have seen so clearly this Advent season. This time of year does invite us to acknowledge our ancient longing for the light, and open ourselves to see how the light of the world, the light of Christ, comes to us and through us. How does this light that is more ancient than imagining travel across an astounding expanse to reach us and to change our world? This is a light that loves searching out what is hidden or in peril or in pain. This light has a desire to be shaped and formed in and through our bodies, and it shines brightly through our eyes when we use it to bring peace and justice through the work of our hearts and our hands. In 2 days' time, we will gather in this space again. We will sing the familiar carols, we will hear the ancient words, and we will be inspired by the beauty created by composers and our musicians. And on that night, as we celebrate the light of Christ, we will have the opportunity to become the light by giving gifts that will literally change people's lives. This year, our Christmas offerings will go to eliminate medical debt for our siblings across Los Angeles. Working in partnership with a nonprofit that purchases crippling medical debt for thousands of people, we have the opportunity to say yes as Mary did. A yes that comes from the daring strength and stunning grace that we have received in this sacred place. As we wade through a world that is giving us ample room for sorrow, the savoring of love has almost become a countercultural activity, an act of courage and resistance, and one the practice of which can become our entire life's work. We have to practice it daily because it is central to participate meaningfully in our world. The potential to change lives has always been part of the Christmas story. This year, we have the opportunity to play a major role in bringing that possibility to people in our city. So on this last Sunday of Advent, together, let us choose love. Let us choose inclusion and empathy, compassion, equality, dignity, diversity. Let us choose community, kindness, integrity, honesty, respect. Let us choose justice. Let us choose facts. Let us choose peace, the planet. Let us choose humanity. Let us choose. May it be so. May it be so for all of us.